Hey guys, insight number three. We're talking about Jericho falling in this one. So chapter six covers the fall of Jericho. It starts off with the Lord saying saying that it's got really big walls, but we already knew that. And then the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given into thine hand Jericho. And this is a kind of language that was used like of future things. So I'm telling you that I've already given it to you. You've just got to actually go get it. So that's kind of cool. But he then gives them very specific instructions on how to do this. And they sound really strange. Now, if the story is familiar to you, you're going to go, yeah, they were. If they're not, go read it, because it's actually a really, really good story. And it has a lot to do with numbers, because we know the Lord loves numbers for some, really, he's a real mathematician, something beautiful in the whole numbers, and I kind of get it, but, you know, numbers create all of it, it's behind everything, so, interesting. But anyway, numbers mean a lot, they have symbolism. So, he said to compass the city, do it 6 days, not 7 days, because seventh is the Sabbath, so 6 days. But you've got to have seven priests before the ark, seven trumpets of ram's horns on the seventh day. You shall compass the city seven times, and the priests shall blow with the trumpets. So on the first 6 days, all they need to do is walk around the city. And you can see the people inside going, what the heck are they doing? Are they lost? Are they going to fight us? Is this like a tactic to get us to come out and say, are you being weird? Like, what's going on? It's just confusing them. But on the seventh day, which probably wasn't the Sabbath, I would say. Maybe it was. I don't know. But anyway, on the seventh day, just says on the seventh day, Joshua, the son of Nun, that's how it's pronounced, called the priest, told them what to do, and they didn't even question it. Doesn't record that they questioned it. I'm sure they're sort of thinking, this is a bit weird. And they walked around and didn't do anything. Except they blew on the trumpets and told them not to make any noise. Told the people, the army marching around, don't make any noise until that seventh day when I'm going to tell you to shout. And that's in verse 10. So the 7 and 13. They got up early in the morning, and off they went, and did this, bearing seven trumpets of the ram's horns for the ark of the Lord, went on continually, blew the trumpets, and the army went before them, but the rear would come up the ark, and blowing on the trumpets, and that was it. All they did was blow on trumpets, walk around the city. You're like, okay, sounds strange. Came to pass on the seventh day, this is verse 16, and the priest blew with the trumpets, Joshua said to the people, shout, for the Lord hath given you the city. You can imagine their shout, right? And the walls fell in. The wall fell in. Now, I'm like, okay, for me, the wall either fell into the city, killed a bunch of people, not the side with Rahab on because she's saved, or they were far enough away that when the wall fell, because these were high walls, it didn't hurt any of them. So I'm not sure there, but it fell. And they actually went and had to clean out like everything, burn it down, kill everyone, kind of really quite harsh sounding stuff. But again, read that stuff in the Come Follow Me manual. That's really going to help you understand why this sounds really harsh and why it had to happen. It is a different time. It's putting your, you know, ancient glasses on to see it, how that time was. But anyway, Jericho falls. What do you learn about Christ and doing his things his way from this account? Because that's really what it was about, doing things the Lord's way. The Lord could have said to them, I will let you overcome the city, just go in and fight them. Go in and bang on the gate, I'll break the gate down for you and you can go pick them off. Because if the Lord needed that to happen that way, then it would happen that way, right? So this is the Lord teaching them specific obedience. And that's how it kind of feels for us sometimes, I think, is because who of us has not faced formidable walls that seem so high, like that mountain to climb where the summit is out of sight in the clouds and you're like, are you kidding me with this? This is impossible. And you feel that it's impossible. And you just feel it's, yeah, simply impossible for someone so incapable as you are. Like, why me? I can't do this. This is too much. These instructions from the Lord are unexpected and seemingly strange, yet they worked. The Lord, too, guides us and gives us instructions that at times seem like they just leave us going, huh? What? Okay. Sure. I'll do that. It's weird, right? And yet they work. So if done with faith and exactly as he says, it works every time. We might feel like we're going in pointless circles, just like these guys might have felt. Yet when that command to shout comes, be prepared for the miracle. So, think of that. When that command to shout comes, are you ready for that miracle? Have you been preparing? Maybe the walking around was preparing them for it. Maybe they needed to get some physically fitness. I don't know the reason. The Lord knows the reason. We just need to do what the Lord asks us to do and it will work out. But for sure, when that call comes to shout, when that moment of the miracle happens, be ready for it, because it will be big and huge and overwhelming. And just, you know, expect it. We've been told to expect miracles. So are you expecting them? Or when it happens, are you kind of like, oh my gosh, it was unexpected, I'm so surprised. Or you're just like, ah. To me, like, when these sort of miracles happen, I'm kind of like, gotcha, you did a good job on this one. Like, I acknowledge it and I'm thankful for it. Some of them still get me like, wow, that was big. That was really big. I did not expect that one. But thank you. And we've been told to expect miracles. Our prophet has told us, expect miracles. So start looking for them, because they're everywhere. They really are. They're everywhere. Anyway, Thomas S. Monson, our previous prophet, he said, do not pray for tasks equal to your abilities, but pray for abilities equal to your tasks. Then the accomplishment of your tasks will be no miracle, but you will be the miracle. Isn't that cool? Do not pray for tasks equal to your abilities, right? Pray for abilities equal to your tasks. So dream big, go bigger, because then the accomplishing of it isn't the miracle. You're the miracle. And that's the growth. And that's the true lesson in all of this, is you are the miracle. All right. Hang around for insight number 3. We're going to go and talk more about my wonderful buddy, Caleb. He's awesome. Okay, I'll see you there.